Hey, good afternoon. Turn it up in the back for me. Turn it up. All right, this is Gloria and Stefan. Get on your feet. I know it's the 3 o'clock hour. You've been up all day. Come on, let's get a little energy. Come on. Get on your feet. Come on, y'all. Just do a two-step. If you can't dance, just stay right here. Just right here. Come on, come on. Get on your feet. Come on. Let's get a little energy. You can take it down. Go to your seats. Thank you so much. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. How's everybody feeling? Okay, you can do better than that. How are you feeling? Well, it is great. We have been having a wonderful conference. And for this afternoon, we have a wonderful conversation with Jorge Zamanillo, the founding director of the Smithsonian's National Museum of the American Latino. Now, in the legislation establishing it, Congress stated that the purpose was to illuminate the story of the United States for the benefit of all, excuse me, by featuring Latino contributions to the art, history, and culture of the nation since its early history. Now, while the Smithsonian is evaluating possible locations for the new museum, Zamanillo is providing leadership and strategic direction for the museum. He's also guiding their comprehensive plan to preserve, document, display, interpret, and promote knowledge of Latino history, art, and culture. He and the staff are also integrating into building on programs from the previous Smithsonian Latino Center. Now, in June 2022, they opened the Molina Family Latino Gallery, the first gallery dedicated to Latino history and culture at the National Museum of American History. Now, if you haven't been, I strongly urge you to go. The current exhibition, Presente, is phenomenal. It is an amazing story that they have done tremendous work with. Now, I'm sure hopefully you've had an opportunity to meet some of the staff who's had an exhibit booth in the exhibition hall. They are traveling the country. They're doing amazing work. And he's going to talk to us about a little bit about that today. And in our prep conversations, I asked him, I said, okay, look, I hope you guys are going to learn from the African American History and Culture Museum, because we all want tickets, right? We want to get tickets when they open. So I hope he's working on that as well. Now, you know, we're not regular here, so we have to make an entrance. So ladies and gentlemen and everyone, please make some noise for Chris Miller and Jorge Zamanillo.
Thank you very much, Noel. I hope all of you are enjoying your time here with us. We have an outstanding conversation ahead of us. But before we dive into the conversation, I'd like to have the opportunity to share this video preview of Somos by Alberto Ferraros. And so if we can have that queued up so that we can watch this video, and then we're going to get into the conversation.
Hard to do a description of the Latino community in sort of one sweeping statement.
In and of itself, it's a wonderfully diverse community. And I'm not sure non-Latinos actually realize that.
Pretending that a Mexican is the same thing as an Argentinian is as ludicrous as saying someone from Brooklyn is the same as someone from Texas.
To be a Latino in Argentina, it was one thing. To be a Latino here, it was quite different.
Not all Latinos speak Spanish. Not all Latinos are Catholic. Not all Latinos are brown. Not all Latinos like spicy food, you know?
There are plenty of Latinos that are black, Latinos that are white, white, Latinos that are trans and queer, and Latinos that are cis and straight. There are Latinos that are Republicans and Democrats. And the point is that there is no one Latino experience.
And anytime you try to think of this community as monolithic in some way, you're gonna get it wrong.
We're an ethnicity. We're not a race. We actually are all races. That's why when you come across a group of us, you really can't pinpoint what a Latin look actually is.
And yet so similar. At the same time, I know, it's complex.
We come from different classes and different statuses. And I think what unites most Latinos is our struggle.
The need to have a strong voice. I think that's what unifies us.
I learned one thing about the Latinos, that they all want their children to succeed.
The thing that really unites all Latinos is a love of family.
What is that thing that makes us one group? Let's keep asking that question.
Everybody contributes to the American story, regardless of what they're doing. That's the nature of the American story, is it is inclusive. That just literally, by existing here at some point, you have contributed to the American story.
Everything that happens in Puerto Rico is also a part of that American story.
We may not have come on the Mayflower, but we were here. And so much of what is America, what we have come to know as American, we created and contributed to.
The American story is a story of people coming from other countries to the United States and bringing everything about the richness of their heritage here and adding it to this whole American story.
Half of the U.S.-born Hispanic population is currently under the age of 19. That really speaks to what the future of the Hispanic population is. It's one that'll be driven by its youth, and it's also one whose impact on the United States is still to come.
One of the biggest things that I would say most Latinos, if not all Latinos, have in common is we are resilient. We are incredibly resilient.
Jorge, that video is fantastically revealing. I remember the first time I watched it, I learned so much. It provoked me to think certain things. And so my question to you is there anything more you can unpack about this video project? I understand there is a longer video. We, for the sake of time, we showed the shorter version, but could you share more about
the
video project?
I'd love to. First of all, thank you for coming today. Thank you for having me, inviting me to this conversation. I really appreciate it. It's an honor. So that is a 2-minute version of a longer 14-minute video that we have in our Molina Family Latino Gallery at the National Museum of American History. And Alberto Ferraros did a beautiful job during the pandemic producing this video and gathering as many people as he could find during this troubled time to come together in the studio. And he filmed that entire thing on his iPhone, which is amazing. It shows you the power of our phones. I couldn't believe it. But so it's a 14-minute version, and we have this version on our website. And it really helps us frame what it means to be Latino, or at least ask that question. You know, how do you shape our identity, right? What is this community all about? And we pose that question to them. And they leave it as an open-ended question. And everyone that comes into the gallery, into the little orientation visitor area, the theater, they love it. They come away with a deeper understanding of what we're trying to explain, what we're trying to achieve. And I hate to say, every time I watch, I still get a little teary-eyed. It's emotional. It's really powerful. And when you watch the longer version, it's even stronger. So it's an excellent way to frame what we're trying to do. So every time I go out and speak to different groups and organizations, I always try to at least include the shorter version because it helps a lot.
I think that should also challenge us. We think we need a big budget, right, to record a video, and most of what we need, sometimes all you need is a phone and a good eye.
Exactly.
I too am America. That is the conference theme. Can you share with us what that theme means for you and the work that you are doing?
Yeah, it's so important, and that's a question that we've been asking even leading up to the 250th. You know, what does it mean? And it means, it's such a difficult question for our communities across the United States. Just like someone mentioned in the video, if you're from Argentina, Venezuela, from New York versus Texas, that's the same issue we're going to have in this community. It's a very divided community in a way. We're still trying to shape what it is. So if I visit someone in Los Angeles, I'm from South Florida, someone in New York, it's all about that American experience, not from what happened in their country, but the experience coming into the United States and their shared experiences, those commonalities that they have that help shape our community. And that's what we need to ask. So when you ask them about what does it mean to be American, it's a loaded question, right, for all of us, but especially in these communities. Imagine being in a border town along Texas. What does that mean to you if you just arrived here a few weeks ago? Your family's been here for a couple of years. And I hate to say it, if you're being persecuted, you're being forced to leave, or you're being always threatened not to have citizenship, those are questions that they face. They might not be the same as my parents that arrived in the 60s and have been in South Florida, you know, for 50 years. It's completely different. So that's something that we struggle with. You know, how do we address those concerns about being American, what it means to be American? It's not going to be a simple answer.
I think that's very important to understand. You know, the community is not monolithic. There are different diverse perspectives, circumstances that help shape that understanding and how they view their perspective in America. And I think that's very important. You also see that in the video that you shared. I want to make sure that I'm getting this correctly, because I, through our conversations, I thought that this statistics, you know, is very important to share as we continue this conversation. There are 63 million Latinos in America with lineage from 32 countries with diverse cultures and languages. With that understanding, can you provide greater context to the multiplicity and diversity of the Latino communities?
Sure. You know, it's interesting. I was speaking to someone earlier today. The new numbers came out, the new stats came out from the Pew Research Center on the Latinos in the United States. And that number grows exponentially, by the way. When the commission originally was formed to try to create this museum, there's only 23 million Latinos in the 90s. And it's now 63 million. So you see this exponential growth. It's amazing. And what does it mean? You know, we know that it's a younger generation. We know that most of the population is younger, which is important because that's going to be their future. We know that the GDP for the revenue generated by Latinos in the United States is larger than most countries in Europe, which is France, Italy, and England. That's amazing, the outcome, the product there. So it's you know, you start looking at all those numbers, and you realize that when we plan for this museum, we're really planning for the future. What does this community look like? Which is not easy. You know, we've asked this question before, what does a museum even look like in 10 or 12 years when we open? And that's something we need to grapple with, not only about technology and digital and audience engagement, but what does our population look like? Because suddenly in many places, including where I'm from, South Florida, you know, I went from being a minority in the 70s to being a community that was 80% Spanish speaking, and 75% of those are native speakers. That's an incredible number, and transformation in less than 20 years. So we got to think about those.
I know that I actually was exposed to that a little bit in the tri-state area where I lived. While I was achieving my master's, we did this exhibit on foodways in that region. And so in the greater Cincinnati area, there's this thing called Cincinnati chili. It is something special. I will let you know that. We have a few fans out there. I can explain about it more, but one of the things that I found out in going into, I tell people that the south side of Cincinnati is actually northern Kentucky. Yeah. And it's just right across the river. And in northern Kentucky, there's a large Guatemalan population, to the fact that you can find authentic bodegas and food choices that are related to that culture. And so I know we were talking about, you know, this growth mm-hmm. of the Latino communities in unexpected places.
Yeah. We mentioned from that Pew Center numbers, the largest Cuban population in the United States, largest area with Cuban growth, is Kentucky near Louisville. It's an amazing number. And I'm jealous because I have a Cuban restaurant, and there is no Cuban restaurant where I live in Virginia. So it's a little complicated. I told my wife, we really should open a Cuban restaurant. But it shows, you know, unexpected places. We know that the Mexican-American population is not as growing as steadily as it used to. We know there's more Venezuelans coming to this country. And again, this is reflective because economic political turmoil in their countries and other push and pull factors, right? So those are things we need to track and to really keep an account, understand the story, you know, why this is happening and predict where this is going to lead us.
Absolutely. And so we, through this conference, we're going to have some uncomfortable conversations, necessary conversations, meaningful conversations. And in preparing for this, you know, I want to talk about identification and racial categories because I play a significant role in the American narrative. And something I personally ask you that I had curiosity, which others, is understand the contrast between Hispanic and Latino heritage. Mm.
It's a tricky one. I get asked this all the time. And now there's new terms and non-gender specific and Latinx and Latine. And there's some controversy with that. And we get a lot of pushback, especially some members of Congress that don't like any of those terms. But, you know, it's interesting. I grew up identifying as Cuban-American and Hispanic. Mostly that's an East Coast thing. I mean, the term Latino is not even created until the 70s for a census count. But it's mostly on the West Coast, other areas. What we tell people all the time is you identify as you wish to be identified. And that's what's most important when you come into the museum. Our name was created by legislation, believe it or not. I mean, you know, the Smithsonian didn't pick the name of the museum. We were tasked to build a museum. That's how it always works. And we've accepted that, and we use Latino, Latina as terminology, male and female, but it's the way the language has been shaped over the years. But who am I to say what you identify as, right? It's going to be tricky. But it's definitely a regional thing. It's really complicated. And we've surveyed and we've met with many people and they say, I don't want to be called either one. I am an American, I am Cuban American, I'm Venezuelan American, and that's who I am. So.
Interesting. Yeah. So there still seems to be some, I would say, as far as not conflict, but there's some still wrapping their minds around how to be identified, and it's not really a simple answer as you.
It's not, and we have to remember it's about the American Latino experience. So many people haven't really shaped that identity, right? Being here in this country, compare someone that's been here for 30 years versus 2 years. And one of the people in the video mentions, you know, coming from Argentina as an adult was very different than coming as a kid, you know, learning a new language and adapting to a new country. And when you start interviewing people and you realize that their stories are really shaped by their environment, by their community, and now we're trying to identify and create this Latino community overarching one across the United States, and it could be a little confusing.
Now, we talk a little bit about the contrast. I don't want necessarily or differences within the Latino communities. Can we also talk about a little bit about the commonalities that unify communities, specifically through ancestry?
Yeah. You know, one thing, I mentioned this before, you know, what are the shared experiences? What are the commonalities? I always like to point out, I mean, how many people here do, like, family tree or ancestry, 23andMe? I'm sure a lot of us do as historians, right? But I would do mine and in my family's, and I have a grandfather from the Basque area. I'm dying to visit today, by the way, the Basque community here. My other grandparents came from Canary Islands, and they went to Cuba. A couple of went to Cuba in 19-teens. They were one of eight. The other seven went to Mexico, Venezuela, Colombia, Argentina. They went everywhere, right? They were fleeing Spain. Civil war unrest. So I have first cousins that grew up Mexican-American. You know, they're here now in the United States. So when I do my DNA, I'm like, what are all these dots everywhere? And they're all my first and second cousins, and they're all related to me. And we share, you know, two generations away. We share a common ancestor, but we grew up with different heritage. But then when we speak, we have so many things in common. just between food and customs and traditions that we carry, some from our grandparents and some from growing up in a different country. So it's just incredible when you start shaping that and mapping it out, what we end up with. We were talking with someone 2 days ago from Google about how can we visualize these things? Because we do some of that in our gallery already, but how can we visualize these stats so people have a better understanding about what we're talking about visually? Use different ways to engage. And I would love to see a map of the world, right? Showing these connections and these arrows and these push and pull factors and migration patterns. And when you think about it, I used to say this all the time when I was in South Florida, everyone's from somewhere else. We all arrived there at one point or another over the past thousands of years. And I would love to see that for this community.
Would that be something that could be a part of the museum?
Yeah.
You know, to show the diversity in the locations and the geography, would that be something that...
Definitely. That's what shapes those connections, those roots that you wanted to show, the common bonds.
Outstanding. And so, you know, in our conversation, we talked about what are the priorities that you see within the community. And one of the things that you mentioned was the importance of faith and family. Mm-hmm. And so can you share with us more about the importance and the priority of faith and family within the Latino communities?
One thing we do, and I'm a former curator, and I'm sure many of you are, is that we try to be unbiased, right? We try to have a balanced story, and we say we're going to do that and speak to communities and engage with many people to hear what the stories are we want to share. But are we being honest about that? It's very difficult to do that, to capture everybody's story. But luckily, I'm not sure, is Adrian in here from our museum? I think he's back there. So Adrian, he's with our education department, and he's been traveling to cities across the United States. I think you've been to, how many, over 38 already? And he has a lot more to go. he's leaving for Seattle on Sunday. But the incredible thing is that he's meeting as part of this larger grant for a mobile museum, Museo Móvil. And he's engaging with communities and trying to find out what their values are and what things they would like to see in a museum. And we're going to do a larger tour, by the way. We're taking off this to the next level over the next few years, not only for collecting stories, but objects and other things for the museums. But he's uncovered that, you know, there are many people in the Latino community that have very conservative values, which, you know, we didn't think that was true. And faith and family and freedom, these are things that stand out. So if we want to be honest with ourselves and be sincere about being balanced and capturing everyone's voices, we need to do that, right? We need to listen to those stories also. And not to be a critic, but I'm guilty of it too. Sometimes our exhibits are just, you know, mostly tailored to one side, right? Because it's a curator's vision. But when you're building a national museum and trying to represent an entire nation, it's not the same. If I was in Miami doing an exhibit, I know exactly kind of which direction to go. And agree with most people. You're never going to make everybody happy, right? I have a funny saying I used to tell my staff back then. Does anybody know what a croqueta is? So I wanted to have shirts made because everybody would complain to me as a director of the museum. And I had a shirt that said, I'm not a croqueta. I can't make everybody happy. Because in Miami,
I think I'm going to be one of those.
But again, we're never going to make everybody happy. It's going to be a huge task to do that. And what we want to do is make sure that we're presenting a fair and balanced story. Yeah.
That is some very good work. And we're going to revisit the mobile museum because I want to talk a little bit more about that as well. So in preparation for this conversation, I wanted to do a little bit of homework. Found that the mission of the museum is one of family, which we talked about, patriotism, hard work, ingenuity, pride in the country we've all built together, really aligns with the conference theme. The museum aim is to recognize the accomplishments, history, culture of the Latino communities. Will you share with us what excites you the most about the inevitable opening of the museum?
Besides the good food and the music? I hate to be a stereotypical, but you know it's going to be great. It's a big question. And I don't take this responsibility lightly, by the way, of leading this effort, because I know it could be a little daunting sometimes and think about something that's 10 or 12 years away. and raising over $500 million and finding a location, design, architecture, all these great things we really want to get to work on. But I really look at it as, you know, this place of a national significance on the mall that finally people can have representation, right? And we experienced this with the African American History Culture Museum that Lonnie Bunch built. And I'll give you an example. We had our Molina family, Latino, we had a Presente exhibit opening in June, last June when I got there. And it was amazing. I was over, you know, I just arrived in DC. There's over 600 people at this opening, famous celebrities. We had Jose Feliciano, the Puerto Rican guitarist, the blind guitarist, singing the national anthem on the stage. You know, Dr. Biden was there speaking, giving some comments. And I was like, what am I doing here? This is the weirdest thing. I'm sitting backstage with Lonnie, and he's like, you know, welcome to the Smithsonian. And I'm like, this is a little too much. But so it was an incredible night. It really was. But the most amazing thing about that week is I came back that Saturday for the public opening, and there were thousands of people lined up to visit a 4,500 square foot gallery. Not the entire museum, just one gallery. And it was like that for months. Constant, nonstop, and we would speak to them, and they were like, I came from Texas, I came from California, Miami, New York, they were from everywhere. So it was this pilgrimage already, just like what happened in Amok, where people were coming in and waiting for this museum to open. They were doing the same thing, and there were tears in their eyes, there was laughter, joy, because they finally saw their stories being told. So imagine, and when this museum opens in 10 years, or more, you know, 12 years maybe, when it opens, and finally you see even more stories being told, more representation, and a much more diverse exhibits, it's going to be amazing. And that's what I look forward to, the public actually engaging and seeing it for the first time.
Absolutely. I just want to make sure I have my ticket, you know, because I want to make sure I get in. Oh, and Noel as well. Yeah, absolutely.
We want to make sure. I reserve some for you.
Y'all going to have to get your own tickets. There is the elephant in the nation, I should say, especially when it comes to what history is elevated, what history is important. And so how do you envision taking on the challenges of the social climate of today, as well as the funding efforts because of the content that is aimed to be shared in the museum?
Yeah. So has anybody done this? If you have time, do a search for our museum in my name, and you'll have, there's a lot of controversy out there with certain members of Congress.
We call that good trouble, though.
It's good trouble. I say all publicity is good publicity, right? So, and I love it. I love the passion that people have behind something, as long as it's real and they've taken the time to study and visit the exhibit and understand what's going on and what we're trying to get across. And it's not just hearsay and he said, she said kind of thing. But so, you know, we have our critics, which is good. I think every exhibit, every museum is always going to have their critics. So I appreciate the passion. But at the same time, I understand it's going to be an uphill battle for making sure that we can tell those stories of resiliency and struggles. And also, you know, the flip side to that, right? The flip side to the coin, which is celebrating legacies and achievements. So you got to find that balance. And it's like I said before, not everybody's going to be happy about it. But it's going to require, you know, building a lot of community partnerships, a lot of relationships with members of Congress. I'm usually up there, like, you know, once or twice a month, asking and having conversations with members of Congress, trying to make sure they understand what we're trying to do, trying to get their support. Because, like I said, I have to raise a little bit over $500 million. They kick in the other half, and those appropriations are controlled by the Appropriations Committee. And if there's members of Congress that are on that committee that don't agree with our content, it's a tough one, you know. But the secretary and I are both behind it. We're never going to censor what content we have in the exhibits, but we got to make sure that we ride that thin, you know, a fine line between, pardon my French, pissing people off and getting the job done. So you really have to look at the big picture. You know, where are we and where do we need to get to? This is a big task, and we're going to need them to be behind us. So, and the way we do that is by building that awareness, by that public engagement campaign, where so many people are behind us and supporting us that eventually the voters and their constituents are the ones that are speaking for us and want to make sure that this happens.
With that being said, how can we individually, collectively, through our respective organizations, through this wonderful association as well, how can we be supportive? How can we be good allies in your efforts to get to that finish line?
Yeah. Well, this is a start. You know, this is where we're doing. You know, just by all of you inviting John and the rest of you inviting me here to speak, it's a few hundred other people that know what we're doing. Because not many people outside of D.C. or the museum communities do know what's going on. And we found that by visiting different communities, we noticed, like, what are you doing exactly? I didn't even know this museum existed. I thought I was in Los Angeles. I thought it was in Texas. I thought it opened 10 years ago. So you still have a lot of that. It's like, I wish it did open 10 years ago. But so, you know, there's still a lot of that kind of public engagement that we need to you know, make sure it happens, that public awareness. So this month and next month, during Hispanic Heritage Month, we're launching a membership campaign. Because we know that buy-in from the beginning, at $20, $25, $30 for members, Lonnie had great success doing that with the African American Museum, where these are sustaining members for years, and that's a few million dollars a year that comes in just from memberships. Because you're small, you know, you're scaling up. It's not just a local, regional museum. It's a national audience with millions of people. So we know that's one of the first steps. And of course, we've removed that barrier already at the Smithsonian, where these museums are free. So there has to be a way to generate revenue to sustain and build this museum. So we'll get there, but this is exactly the kind of thing we need to do, and it's kind of my life for the next 10 years, right? A lot of travel, a lot of getting out there, spreading the word, raising money, and hopefully soon start collecting.
So that means you're going to be on the lecture circuit, and so he needs to come to a town near you.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So you mentioned about the mobile museum. I find it fascinating. Can you talk more about, it's an outreach initiative with communities across the country. And so the concept, how did that come about? Is it something that you had awareness was done previously and you're building upon that? I find it very fascinating how you're doing that in trying to collect stories and so forth.
Well, I can't take credit for that. That was an initiative that Adrian and the rest of the Latino Center team started before I got here. And they have a planning grant to look into the right way to do this. So eventually he'll be driving, not flying city to city, he's going to be driving a bus across the United States and offering programming and exhibitions and our story, right? Telling our story to the rest of the nation. I think one of the most important things for me and the team while we wait 10, 12 years is not waiting, is actually making everyone aware of what's going on and making you believe that this museum already exists, because it does exist. We have a gallery, we have programming, we have staff, we have an education center, a learning lounge, and that's the greatest job that I have, right? And the same one that Lonnie said he had, was making members of Congress, our constituents, our members, or everyone involved in this community, making them believe and trust in us that we will get this project built. And this mobile museum is one way to do that. Another thing we're doing is we're making sure that we're supporting, and not just going into communities and taking your stories and your artifacts, is supporting programming and exhibitions. Right now, there's an exhibition traveling from the Riverside Art Museum, from the Sheech Museum, Riverside Art in California, the De La Torre Brothers, a beautiful glass blowing and recycled art exhibit. And we helped open it there last year, and now it's traveling to six different venues across the United States with our funding. And it's gonna go anywhere from Texas to Oklahoma to the Corning Art Museum next year. That's amazing. That would never have happened for these artists if we hadn't been able to support them. So that's one way we're lifting these voices throughout the next 10 years.
So how would an institution explore opportunities of having that traveling exhibit to come to their location?
Yeah. We'll need to build that out. You know, so we're hiring staff now. We have, I think, about 20, 21, many that were with Latino Center already with programming and digital. We're starting to build our curatorial team and some other positions on there. And our plan is hopefully next year to launch this nationwide initiative where we will announce all the cities we're going to be visiting, all the different opportunities there are for partnerships and collaborations. Because there's so much out there we could do with almost every museum in the nation.
Great, great. That's great work. I know that often I've come across wanting to tell a story, but not having enough 3D images or artifacts and things of that nature to effectively tell the story. So can you tell us, on the road towards the museum opening, what does the collection process look for you?
Yeah. I want to make sure that when we start collecting a few items already, but I want to make sure that the larger collecting initiative has some clear strategies. And I now know that the Smithsonian does not have unlimited storage space. And if I want more storage space, I'm gonna have to pay for it and build it. And it takes years and years to build a storage space. So we're gonna have to borrow, right? And our good friends at African American and American Indian are helping us put some pieces here and there, and some extra drawers and storage areas. But it's tough, because there's another Women's History Museum being built at the same time. We're all going to need that, you know, extra capacity to grow. So I want to make sure we have some clear objectives, like what is it we're collecting? I don't want to create a burden. Some of you are in collection space. Do you want to create this burden where you have thousands of artifacts that are sitting there unused, unstudied, not digitized, inaccessible? I do not want to do that, and that happens a lot in everybody's museum, including ours. And Smithsonian museums are probably even more guilty of that, because they have millions of pieces that have been there for hundreds of years. And there's no way you can get to everything, right? So you start developing the program, the plan. So what does this museum look like? What is the story we're trying to tell? And of those themes and topics we're trying to share with you, which of those can we visually exhibit, right? What things can we find to help tell those stories? And sometimes you can't tell something because you don't have a piece, or sometimes you have too many of one thing. So it's a fine balance. And I know the first thing that would happen, and it did, is the minute I got my job, I started getting emails every week saying, by the way, I have this incredible piece that you can have or you can buy from me. Because nobody donates things that easily anymore, right? But we do get a lot of offers for incredible collections, and we're looking into some of them because they are unique. And as you know, from the collections perspective, you worry about them being there and being available eventually if they get given away, or conservation issues, or they're stored in the garage or in the attic. So you worry about all these things. So we have some efforts right now out in the field, but we're going to hire new collections managers and specialists and technicians to help us do that. But I wanted to share one quick story. I have 5 minutes to...
No, yes.
I'll give you an example of the way I look at collecting. I remember when I first got my first museum job in 2000, History of Miami in South Florida. The first day I get there on the desk, I find this leather wallet, and I start flipping through it, and there's an ID card from Cuba, photo of a young girl, and nothing else. And it says it's associated with this metal boat that was found and drifting in Marathon Key, and we had in our collection now. And I was like, well, this is interesting. It actually has an ID. We know who might have come in this boat. But it's an example of how the power of one simple little thing can really tell a story. So I started, it was back in 2000, by the way. You couldn't Google people's names or addresses or phone numbers yet. So I get the idea, and I go crazy trying to find out who this person, his name was Yuri Gardente Hernandez. He had a Russian Cuban name, left over from the Russian occupation of Cuba. So I find this idea, and I say, I gotta find this person. This might be the person that came on this boat, but there's nothing else in this metal, crude, Frankenstein-looking boat, made of sheet metal and screws everywhere, with a Russian inboard generator motor, and a big Ford steering wheel on it. I'm like, this must be an amazing story. So I started looking everywhere for this guy's name, and I opened, does anybody know what a phone book is here?
Or a phone booth.
So I go through our archives, and we had every white pages for, going back to the 30s or 40s. And I started looking through all of the, I start going back and forth, and I cannot find anybody named Yuri Hernandez anywhere. And I'm going crazy. I can't find it online. And then I was talking to my mom, and she said, why are you looking under Yuri Hernandez? That's his, when you come to the United States, you usually drop your mom's maiden name. And it was Yuri Cardente you should be looking for. I'm like, so clueless. So the first thing I do, I look it up, and there he is. There's a Yuri Cardente. He's like maybe a mile from downtown Miami. So one day after, I start calling, and nobody would answer. There's no answer machine. It's not a cell phone. It's a landline. And I can't get through. So I said, I'm just going to show up at this guy's house. I'm like, who cares? I'm going to go by. And it's like 7 o'clock at night. And, of course, why would he be home at 2 in the afternoon? He's working, right? And there's no answer machine. So I knock on the door, and this guy opens the door. He's like, who are you? He's kind of scared. And he's there. I think his wife was with him. And I show him the wallet, and he just breaks down in tears. Wow. So that's his daughter that he had left in Cuba, and that was his ID from Cuba. And he had what he tells me is an incredible story. I can't share with you now because it would take too long. But basically, they built this boat piece by piece over 2 or 3 years in his backyard. He worked at an auto body shop for the government, and every day he would take one screw home with him.
Wow.
And he put together all his sheet metal, and every little screw in that boat looked like a Frankenstein boat. They launched it, him and his brother. In the middle of the night, they launch. The boat breaks down, doesn't even make it out of the river, up, you know, trying to get into the bay. Mm-hmm. So they go back, they drag it back into his backyard covered with a tarp, and they need to find this part for a carburetor. So they find somebody who has a carburetor, and he says, well, I have the part, but if you do that, you're going to have to take me and my cousin. I'll give you the part if you take both of us also. And by the way, it ends up being five people. All five of them take off in the middle of the night, and a couple weeks later, they make it out, past the patrols and the guards and the, you know, the boats patrolling the coast of Castro's government. They're terrified. They're sitting on these gas cans for seats full of fuel. They make it out to the middle of the ocean, storms and sharks everywhere. Boat breaks down. It's 90 degrees outside. They're dying out there, right? They're running out of water. And suddenly they see this freighter come by. And they say, well, you know, they could save us or they might take us back in. So he changes to his swimming trunks and he rolls up his pants with his wallet and he puts it under the console of the boat. And then he says, I'm going to climb the rope ladder to the top of the boat, and if it's Soviet government or non-friendlies, you know, I'll take my hat off and throw it into the ocean. If not, if I keep my cap on and keep on going up the rope ladder, it's safe. So it turns out to be a Swedish ship, I think, or something from Norway. It's safe. They rescue them all. But the boat stays adrift, right? Floating in the middle of the bay, of the ocean, the straits, with his wallet inside. Wow. And so it washes up 3 or 4 months later. Somebody picks it up, donates it to the museum. And their wallet was sitting there for 3 years, 3 or 4 years. Well, actually 2000. It's sitting there for 6 years. And he didn't even know this existed. So I get the story together. Eventually, make a long story short, he reunites with his daughter that was in the photo. He brings her over from Cuba. And I had an exhibit, and I put the boat on display, and his entire family was there to see the boat. And it's, by the way, I broke one of the major rules of collections. I let him keep his wallet with his photo and his ID. Anyways, that's the power of one photograph in an ID inside a wallet that had been sitting there for many years and nobody knew. Those are the kinds of stories that I would love to uncover and find that can really shape our identity.
So you played a significant role in reuniting a family.
That's amazing.
That's powerful. Yeah. While you were speaking there, you know, I think regardless of what community you identify with, while you were talking about the struggle and the process to get to a better place, to get to freedom. When you were talking about the boat, from my perspective, I started thinking about Robert Smalls. And, you know, that story and how he took that quest of freedom. And I think those stories are rich. They are powerful. They are a part of the story that needs to be told. So that's just a powerful, powerful story. Personally, I find that I would like to see more Black males in the field. Because as I go about, I don't see young Black men seeing this as an opportunity to work in a museum, to work at a historical site. And in our conversations, you talked about this mentorship program that you are going into communities, because you also talked about how many within the Latino community are young, are in the teens and so forth. And so can you talk about that mentorship program and those opportunities for them to see themselves in these spaces?
So one of the incredible things that were started years ago by the Latino Center, by the Smithsonian's Latino Center, is there are a couple of internship programs. We have our Young Ambassador Program with Adrian is part of, right, Adrian? Amazing. How many years ago? You don't want to know. Long time ago. But we also have our Latino Museum Studies program, which is a graduate program that now we also have an undergraduate one. So here, you know, we have 20 in each one, probably 60 interns a year going through the Smithsonian. The Young Ambassador one is not necessarily for museum studies. It's for professional development, networking. But the other one, we're creating a pipeline for future leaders, for future workers, and it could be in conservation, curatorial, anything, marketing, communications, and we place them in Smithsonian units and Smithsonian museums to serve internships and have mentors. And this helps guide them in their decisions making and in their studies. And one thing we've found over the past few years, especially as I've been here, I've noticed every city I go to, including this morning, we had a young ambassador, I run into somebody that was part of this program, because we've been doing it for over 20 years. And it's creating the next generation of people that are working in museums or will work in our museum too. And we know there's an issue, right? We know that there are few people in our Latino community that have the experience or the skills needed to do that. So this is just one way that we're trying to build that pipeline.
I think more importantly, too, making sure that it's visible. They can see someone that looks like them in that position at a young age, so they can start to dream and inspire about having that position. I think, you know, a lot of young people, they've decided by the time they, before they get in their teens, of some idea of what they want to be or what's possible for them. So I think that's very important, that mentorship program. You said you've been doing it for 20 years?
I think over 20 years, And we also have some initiative money, curatorial initiatives pool. So many of the curators that you see in Smithsonian museums today were funded through the Latino Initiatives Pool or through our museum. So we've also built those positions and they become permanent. So 20, 25 years ago, you would not have seen a curatorial position for that, you know, for these people. And it's amazing that now we do have them across museums.
Wow, that's outstanding. I think that deserves a round of applause, don't you think, that effort? Now, I'm going to hit you with another tough question. All right. So we talked about America 250 is very, very big on many institutions. And part of our conversations, we talked about there's an uneasiness in some communities in celebrating America 250. Some communities feel there's really not much for them to celebrate because how the experience they've had in America and seeing themselves in America 250. So can you unpack, you know, what you've been witnessing and some of the conversations that you've occurred or that you've witnessed?
Well, I mentioned it earlier, you know, what does it mean to celebrate the country's, you know, birthday anniversary of the 250th? And for many people that I know in these communities, they don't even know what that is. How would they know what that is? They might know important dates in their countries and their birth, you know, or their heritage, but it's not the same. It's interesting. Last night I was here with some colleagues that might be here having a beer, and we're such, you know, history nerds that instead of talking about other topics, we're talking about the 250th and what it means to certain communities. But it's important. It's on top of our mind, because I know the Smithsonian has an initiative that we're planning on now for the 250. I know AASLH has one. I know Made by Us and other groups have them. We know the Beer Commission is trying to do something. But what is how do we do that? And how do we sustain that beyond 2026, which is the most important thing for us? And programming on the mall, off the mall, how do we get our affiliates connected with this? And it's gonna be very challenging. We know from conversations we've had already with communities that there is a certain disconnect with what that means. And should it really be celebrated? Or is it more about thinking about, you know, how we get to this more perfect union, right? What work still needs to be done to get there? And I think for most of us, that's the bigger question. It's not that we don't want to celebrate it. It's still an unanswered question. And what are we celebrating? And how am I reflected in that story?
Outstanding. We've talked about the audience, the potential museum guests, and how they have evolved over a decade ago. I know in the institution I'm a part of, we will be going through a capital campaign because most of the museum galleries in our space took shape during the late 90s. And so much has changed, and we had the pandemic, and anything that you had with a touch push button, we went to with foot pedals and so forth. And so as you look at projecting out the museum opening, you know, a decade later, can you share how the interpretive and exhibit approaches that you will take knowing that the audience is evolving?
Yeah, that's a big question because we haven't figured that out yet. But I know it's going to be completely different than we even think it will be, right, for a decade away. One of my concerns is, you know, Smithsonian does get federal funding, and a lot of the stuff that we do goes through the federal channels, right? So if you buy a monitor today, it's probably outdated by the time you install it because it took 10 months to buy it. So what's going to happen if we design an exhibit in 10 years? How do we keep up with technology that's so disposable today, right? The TVs you buy in your home, instead of keeping them for 20 years, you keep them for a year or two before they break down, nobody fixes them. So we need to be cognizant that, sure, we want digital, we want technology, but we also have to go back to the power of the real object, the power of the real thing in order to share these stories. So for me, I always go back to that story with the boat and the ID card and the photo. That's always going to be 10 times more powerful to see the real object. But at the same time, knowing that not everybody can visit the museum, so we need to digitize these pieces. We need to make sure they're online, that we share the exhibits online. So it's a balance, right? I say the example all the time. I keep on sharing it. You know, 5-6 years ago, we all used QR codes in our museums, and people didn't use them because they had to open a specific app, and it didn't work, and the QR code didn't work. And as much as we use them or not now, or we hate them or like them, it is easier to use. You open your camera, and the QR code works. Well, that's something that happened because of the pandemic, sadly. Everybody's menu was on QR code at your table, and you learned just to became second nature. You just aim your camera, and you have options. What's going to be that next QR code that develops over the next 10 years? What's going to be that technology beyond our IFRD, whatever it's called, and, you know, scanning and sensing where you're at in the gallery? Last year, I was visiting the College Football Hall of Fame in Atlanta, and you come in, and you put your school, and you have your little tag hanging, and when you walk around, it's showing you content only for the school that you went to. You know, all these different technologies that are coming around, I'm not sure how usable, how practical they are. Do they really work or not? It's just one of those questions that we're going to have to tackle over the next few years. But I still think the powerful storyline and the powerful objects are going to completely override any of that technology.
And you said the power of this. Could you repeat that one more time?
The power of an object or the story, yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think I heard a few amens in the audience with that. Yeah. You know, I grew up during a time period. I remember that commercial. Is it Live or is it Memorex? Right? So, I mean, there's nothing better than the real thing, the live thing. You know, as we stated, when a new museum opens up. I remember when the National Underground Railroad Freedom Center opened up in 2004. The museum on the mall, you know, opened up in how people were trying to get tickets and get in. So we're going to revisit this. How are you going to be prepared to address the visitation demand? You know, are there any thoughts that you have about how you will navigate that, or is that evolving as well?
I have a couple ideas. You know, we know that African American Museum is one of the most popular ones on the mall, and it's because you look at numbers like Air and Space, they always have the highest numbers of attendance, right? Because there's a continuous stream of people going through. Now it's a little different because they're only half open and they're taking time tickets. But the reason that NAMOC, the acronym we use for African American, is so hard to get a pass to get in is because people are there for much longer, right? Instead of a 45-minute visit, it's a 3 or 4 hour visit. That's the deep experience they have, starting at the lower levels and going up to the different floors. And most people don't even finish at one visit. And they have a great restaurant, by the way, too. So that helps. So once you increase that dwell time, then all of a sudden you just have less capacity to take visitors in every day. That's a great problem to have. I hope that's our issue, right? But I'm thinking of how can we make these museums a little more accessible beyond the inside, right? Is there a plaza? We know in most of our Latin American communities there's a public plaza and a space where we gather. Is that public space something that's open on the outside to the public, where you don't have to go inside necessarily? Is there programming on this plaza? Is there a food service and window outside? Or are hours extended beyond 5 o'clock? Because most people work at least till 5:30, right? Can we stay up until 7? Can we shift our hours? And the Portrait Gallery does that, and they're very successful. How do we create this other environment where people can feel safe? I know many people in our community might not even feel safe going into a government building because of their status. So how do we do that? So I'm thinking of other ways where suddenly this becomes more of a community space. And my mission has always been internally to think of my background working with a community-based museum. How can we make a national museum a community-based museum? I mean, we're surrounded by D.C. and Maryland and Virginia, which have an incredible community of Latinos, but museums don't necessarily engage with them, and that's an issue. I know this year, for instance, for Hispanic Heritage Month, we usually do events at American History or another museum. This year, we're taking it out into the community. We're going to have one near Union Station, La Cosecha. We're going out to Glen Echo in Maryland to make sure we have events in the communities that have our community, right? It makes sense. Why wouldn't we do this? You don't necessarily have to go to the mall. It's not only for tourists. It's for the people around you. So I'm hoping this museum will have that kind of extension into the community where people will feel that they don't have to wait a couple of weeks to get a pass or call somebody for a favor, but it's or plan ahead, because most of us don't, right? So we want to make it easier.
That reminds me, I got to make sure I get your cell number before we part. So I know we're getting close to our time. I want to make sure that are there any takeaways or anything that you feel you want to share with us? You can share with us what's next. I mean, you talked about, bringing about awareness. But what's next for you in the development in moving towards, the project?
Well, that next phase, and we're doing strategic planning right now. We're doing things that every other museum does to help develop their vision. But the most important thing for me is just going out there and meeting people every day and making sure we engage with them one-on-one. I know that's going to be my mission for the next few years, as much as my wife is going to hate me for not being home all the time. But it's just so important. And we want to, again, I want to be truthful. If I'm telling people I'm going to engage with communities across the U.S., I have to be there. I have to show face. We got to make sure that we show up. And it's not only for community centers and museums, it's also for congressional leaders and local politicians and local leaders. It's not all about fundraising, it's all about making sure there's a buy-in and an awareness. And for me, that's the next logical phase of this museum.
Outstanding. And so, since we have a little time, you see the shirt that I have on. We had a conversation backstage. How many of you saw Black Panther 2? Show of hands, all right. And so this was my first opportunity. I wanted to get a take on it. I know Noel probably looking at me, Chris, what you about to ask? But, could you share, what was your take as far as the evolving and showing a part of history, a perspective that I don't think people were prepared to know that it was going to go in that direction? From a fantasy fiction type perspective.
Well, those movies are great. First of all, female representation in the last one was incredible, right? So that makes a big difference. But it's mixing a historical narrative. It's making it more accessible, right? Suddenly you have popular, Marvel movies and DC movies and these fantasy movies. They're showing a narrative mixed in with a historical interpretation. We know we all like historical fiction to a certain degree. But suddenly now you have audiences across all ages that can appreciate that also. How do you do that? So I think that's one of the best things that comes out of some of these movies. I'm not sure anything else you want to share that you enjoyed about it?
No, I just wanted to get your perspective. Yeah. I had the opportunity. I took my shot. If you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. So I just wanted to ask you that question. It was on my mind. And so, what we're going to do, can we give Jorge a round of applause, please?
Thank you.
You deserve our support. We personally will make sure you will have my support in your endeavors. But I believe right now we have a special presentation that is supposed to take place, is my understanding. And so if I could...
Mike, can you share with us?
I'm Mike Bunn. Good afternoon. I'm from Mobile, where we're going to hold the conference next year. And I've been involved with AASLH in several capacities, and I'm really happy to have you guys come here to where we're from one time and show you a little bit about what we have. It's going to be totally different than the surroundings that you're in now. It's a little bit, can't imagine a bigger change of pace than going from Boise to Mobile. We have nice, you know, cool mornings and sunny afternoons, but we just call that December. But what we lack in mountain views, we more than make up for in water. We've got rivers, we've got a bay, we've got the Gulf, and we've got incredible stories about how those waterways gave birth to our communities on both sides of Mobile Bay. So we're talking Mobile and the Eastern Shore, where I live. So we're going to get a chance to share with you a little bit about that. And what I'm really excited about in our programming is that part of our touring will actually involve getting you out on those waterways. We're actually going to take you out, offer some special cruises, and that's really going to be an exciting part of what we're doing. A little bit of a unique approach to sharing some of our stories from some of the other conferences I've been to. Looking forward to that. And so I want you to come to Mobile prepared to learn about a really rich history. You know, Mobile was founded in 1702, so we go way back. Come prepared to eat some good seafood. Come prepared to learn how deeply proud we are to be the original home of Mardi Gras in America. Don't be surprised if somebody tells you they're going to throw our unofficial favorite dessert at you, the moon pie. It's not a bad thing, I promise you. So anyway, we've got a quick video about Mobile's history. Look forward to seeing you there.
History rarely follows a straight path. And Mobile's history is no different.
John LaFleur.
Our 300-year-old story winds and turns like the banks of the Tom Bigby River. Through the years, living statues have towered overhead. Watching the growth of our city. From humble beginnings to a center of commerce. We have embraced the currents that formed who we are today. Our cornerstones are as strong as the roots from which we've grown. As the oldest city in Alabama, our traditions span centuries. We have prospered under many flags and continue to fly them every day. Through our culinary options, architecture, and art. From brick-laden streets where legends walked and trolleys rolled, we celebrate the individuals and circumstances that have shaped and molded our city.
Mobile native and home run king Hank Aaron.
What took men years to build took Frederick hours to destroy.
But we're gonna try, we're gonna come back.
Down in Mobile, they're all crazy. The land of clowns, ghosts, and musicians.
We've reached deep into the earth and found relics from times gone by.
A huge finding in the Mobile Tensaw Delta could be the last American slave ship, a dark time in our nation's history.
The banks of the Delta have nurtured and protected our history for generations. our streets are lined with glimpses of the past. And our ancestors live on through the antiquities on our walls. Their stories are rich and captivating. Some you want to hear, while some are hard to hear. But every story must be told, because Mobile isn't just one thing, it is so many. And our 300-year-old story is far from over. Come visit our living history and help us write the next chapter.
All right, well, thank you so much, everyone. That wraps up this afternoon's plenary. I know we have Basking the Block this evening. Enjoy. There are sessions and tours tomorrow. Have a great rest of your day.